Penguin Random House Audio presents Delete That and Other Failed Attempts to Look Good Online. This is the author, John Crist. To Mom and Dad, for your understanding, care, and love. I'll never forget that one night at home when I came downstairs for dinner and you asked me where I'd been sneaking off to all those nights. I finally confessed that I had been going to a comedy club and that one day I wanted to be a stand-up comedian. I can't imagine what that moment must have been like as a parent. I'll never forget the look on Dad's face. From the small bar shows to the arena shows, y'all have been there through all of them. Thank you. I love you both. To my siblings, Benjamin, Barton, Joseph, Elizabeth, Elias, Emma, and Evangeline, for the conversations that y'all have all had to endure that started with, wait, your last name is Crist? Are you related to that comedian guy? And all the subsequent proud, funny, or embarrassing interactions that have come along with sharing the same last name. Thank you. I love you all and your spouses and most of your kids. Preface. Look at you out here listening to a book. You should feel proud of yourself. Look at all those people around you on their phones or staring at their computer screens or watching TV. But not you. Not right now, anyway. You're listening to a book. Impressive. Even if you don't learn anything from this book, even if you don't laugh once, at least it's nice to feel superior to anyone who's on their phone right now. I'd call that a win. And we're only one paragraph in. There's always that one guy at the airport. Everyone is preoccupied, looking at their phones, but there's always the book guy. That's you right now. Take a bow. Airports are a big look at me, I'm reading a book now, spots. Coffee shops are a close runner-up. And it's always got to be some impressively titled book, just to make the optics look better. I'm over here scrolling through TikTok, and the lady next to me is reading How to End World Hunger. And when you board a plane, you've got to carry your book across your chest, cover out, so everyone knows how much of a humanitarian you are. I mean, otherwise, what's the point of reading that book in public? You want to know one exception to the book in airports rule? The Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous. I spent 4 months in rehab in 2019 to 2020, and the first thing they give you a check-in is an AA book. Before I even opened the book, I noticed one thing. It's completely coverless. It's just big and blue. Nothing at all on the cover. No title, no subtitle, no author credit, nothing. I spotted a lady with that big blue book on a flight recently. I whispered to her that I'd read the book too, and we chatted the whole flight, but in low tones, almost as if we were exchanging military secrets. We didn't want anyone to know what we were talking about. I mean, that's why the cover is so nondescript, right? That's why we were whispering. We were supposed to be ashamed, yet there we were on the flight, talking about what we'd gotten from the book and from our experiences gathering real strength from it. I've got an idea. Next time you're reading a book you're embarrassed about, before you leave the house to go to the coffee shop or the airport, just throw a different cover on the book. Sure, you're reading 50 Shades of Grey or What to Do After a Divorce, but your cover says War and Peace or The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. Boom! It's a win-win. In fact, I think the publishers of those highbrow books could even make a killing just selling the covers without the books. That's my million-dollar idea, and I'm giving it away right up top because that's the kind of generous soul that I am. Here's the thing. We're all kind of full of it in that way, aren't we? I'll start with an example. Maybe that'll help. One time I posted an Instagram story from my church on Sunday morning. Later that night, I was drunk at the Red Door Saloon a mile down the street. I did not post about that. In fact, someone tagged a photo of me there, and I untagged myself. Here's another one. One time a fan sent me a DM that read, "I struggle with depression. Your comedy has helped me through some hard times." I reposted it and probably said something like, "This is why I do what I do. Hashtag blessed to be a blessing." The same day, I also got a DM from a woman who told me she loved me and sent me a photo of her in her underwear. I didn't repost that one, but I probably looked at it for way longer. One more? I'm a stand-up comedian. I've subtly bragged about that on the internet 1,000 times. I've also spent significant stretches of time in recent years on antidepressants. I've never posted about that once. Does that make sense? We're all just out here faking at keeping it real and hoping that no one really notices. Was I at church on that Sunday morning? Yes. Was I humbled that my work had helped someone cope with depression? Yes. Am I a successful comedian? Yes. All those things are true, but they're not the whole truth. To be loved but not known is comforting but superficial. To be known and not loved is our greatest fear. But to have both, that is perfection. Timothy Keller said that. And in essence, that's what this book is about. It's full of funny stories about myself and others trying to make ourselves look better than we actually are in appearances, conversations, and on the internet. It's really that simple. Except, of course, it's not that simple at all. And before we really get going here, one really important thing. Whenever you're listening to this book in public, remember to look up every once in a while, for the sole purpose of looking down on the people all around you who are staring slack-jawed at their phones. You're listening to a book now. You're better than them. Never forget that. Introduction. Give me a sec. Not too long ago, I shared an Instagram story from the McDonald's drive-thru. I don't remember what the particular story was about, probably something about how people need to memorize their orders or about the ice cream machine being broken, but it was the responses to that video that really stuck with me. First of all, why are you at McDonald's? Well, that's what you get for eating McDonald's, barf emoji. Do you have any idea how unhealthy that place is? McDonald's, bro? Really? I haven't eaten there since I was 10. I'll never eat there again. I legit found a thumb in my McChicken last week. Okay, that last one was made up, but here's the point. How come no one will ever own up to eating at a McDonald's? How come no one posts a photo of themselves digging into their Big Mac meal deal on Instagram, but they can't stop posting photos of kale salads and cleansing, detoxifying kombucha? According to the internet, the forward-facing version of ourselves, everyone is too good, too healthy, too image-conscious to hit the dollar menu at 2 a.m.? If we're to believe what most of us see on social media, hardly anyone ever eats at McDonald's. But how is this possible? You can't drive 2 miles in this country without seeing one. There's literally a McDonald's on every other block. And every time I drive past one, the parking lot is full and the drive-thru line circles the building. Someone is eating there. Meanwhile, if I were to scroll my Instagram right now, my feed would be littered with pictures of avocado toast, vegan hummus, and some suburbanite preparing a HelloFresh meal. Can we discuss those pre-prepped meal kits, by the way? No one wants to eat quinoa fritters with arugula strawberry salad and walnuts, much less see you post about how super awesome it was to make it. We all know that anyone who IKEAs one of those meals together is thinking, I swear if this meal doesn't work out, I'm ordering pizza. But only after they Instagram a photo of themselves assembling it. It's not just food that we do this with. It's everything. Do you know who the most hated band in America is? Nickelback. They've held that title for decades. It's not even close. They are the punchline to every hack joke about music that everyone hates. But guess what? When Nickelback comes to your town, they're performing at the stadium. Someone is listening to them. Do you see the pattern? I mean, let's look online for 5 seconds. We claim to be a salad-eating, cross-fitting, charity-giving, small-business-supporting, keto-dieting, indie band before they were famous listening, meal-prepping, family-prioritizing, church-attending, Habitat for Humanity volunteering, no-filter-using, Toms-wearing, whales-saving, corporate America-shunning, juice-cleansing, purpose-driven, inclusive, equality-supporting, free-range, fair-trade, environmentally sustainable, gourmet coffee-sipping group of people. But in reality, we're also the McDonald's-eating, couch-sitting, tabloid-reading, Walmart shopping, top 40 listening, lotto ticket buying, beer drinking, meme scrolling, bachelorette binging, Kardashian obsessed, Tinder swiping, double chin having, time wasting, prejudiced, SUV driving, mob tweeting, DM sliding, bikini photo liking, late night Postmates ordering, Pornhub surfing, TMZ loving, too lazy to recycle group of people. And you know who embodies that dichotomy more than anyone? Me. This is my story. This is Delete That. Chapter 1. Want to hear a joke? It was June 12th, 2012. I opened my eyes and I knew something was wrong. I looked around and I could tell I was in a hospital, but I had no idea how I'd gotten there. I couldn't move. My arms, my legs, and my neck were all strapped to the hospital bed. I legit thought I was about to meet the Lord. A nurse came to my bedside. She told me I'd been in a car wreck. My silver 1998 Honda Civic had been T-boned by a Dodge Ram. Generally not a confrontation that ends well for the Civic. I'd been ejected through the passenger side window and landed on the road. Hard. When I got to the hospital, I was having seizures, hence the restraints on my wrists, ankles, and neck. The nurse began to ask me questions. What day is it? Not sure. What are your parents' names? I don't know. Who is the president? No idea. Then I passed out again. When I came to, the scene had changed. Instead of one nurse now, there were at least five doctors and nurses, all gathered around my bed, all looking at me. And they were laughing. I mean dying laughing. I was like, what is everyone laughing at? One of the nurses said, you told us you were a comedian, and you've been telling us all jokes. Me, strapped to the hospital bed, telling jokes, semi-conscious, and apparently, I was crushing. Maybe that's when I knew for sure I was on the right path in life. I don't know if I was born to be a comedian, but certainly by that point, there was something so deeply ingrained in me that wanted, that needed, to make people laugh that I could do.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.